Hello and good afternoon. Richard Miller from Australia. I'll have to get a new byline worked out, you know, like reporting in, right?
Yeah.
And so it's summer, it's hot, and here we are in our little studio room, and help me welcome Daniel Schreiber. So welcome, Daniel.
Thank you, Richard. Good to meet you.
We're all over. We're on the web, and we're in the cold winter countries in the north, and we're maybe we're wherever anyone speaks English. But you
these
know,
days online,
yeah, right.
That's entirely probable.
Something about the way we conceptualize our humanity.
Mm-hmm.
We have a harmony and a discord. Mm-hmm. We have something that's vibrant, and we have something that's blocked.
Mm-hmm.
We have we have our psyche, and we have our mindset, and we have our body, and all these features of the human instrument reflect on this basic openness and closeness, which seems to cycle. And mm-hmm. It seems to cycle so much that it seems like there's a purpose to it, or like that's really the game we're playing in it. And so often we'll say, well, I like the open part, and the closed part, please, no thanks. And so then we're trying to go one way on the teeter-totter, right? And we say, just keep me up, you know? And then, of course, there's another school of thought that says stay on the fulcrum and just watch it, you know, poop, 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 poop. And I'm wondering, like, what is this thing that, you know, I don't know. Let me just say that it certainly encompasses health and disease. And so then we're firm believers in healing. Healing, what is healing?
That's a good question. Healing and an art and shamanic work are all quite closely related. And if I could relay some of my understanding of Joseph Campbell's work, of kind of going to a different realm. And in this realm, there's a lot of what we observe is beyond words. It may have sound, it may have color, it may have shape. And so the role of the artist or shaman or healer is to stretch out to these high vibrational places and prepare themselves in a way so that when they're in these spaces, they can see what it is they're meant to see. Remember, because there's no way of bringing back the information other than with your memory, and then coming back into this reality and acting as an anchor to bring this information back, and then expressing in art or healing this energy that is beyond this physical reality. And so for me, an expression of that, or a way to see where the richness of vibrational energy is what we call beauty. And of course, beauty can be experienced on many different levels. For example, in the body, the experience of bliss or orgasm is energetically when this energy is flowing. And I had an interesting experience once where I went to the dentist, and he gave me some nitrous oxide because he was going to be working on my teeth. And I had a very interesting experience where I found myself in front of an old man with a long gray beard, but he looked like he was me, but maybe in the future. And he called me over and he said, you know, I want to show you something. And I was like, intrigued. I was like, what is it? And he said, have a look at this flower. And it was this beautiful lotus. And I looked at the lotus. And he said, so what's happening now is as you perceive its beauty, there's an energy rising up through your body and coming out of your eyes. And the lotus flower can absorb that energy and grow in beauty. And at the same time, that energy is cycling back and into you, and you are growing in beauty. And what we call this is called love. So I was like, wow, that's a pretty simple explanation. And then he said, well, look over there. And I looked over there and there was a scene of a war. And he said, well, what do you see? And I said, well, it's pretty intense. He said, well, it's ugly, isn't it? And I said, yes. And he said, well, what happens when you perceive ugly is your body starts to constrict because you are resisting that energetic. So no longer is there energy flowing out of your eyes. It's you stopping that energy because you've judged that as bad or ugly.
And so you cut off from it.
Well, yes, because you have a judgment about it, it's restricting the flow of energy in your body. But what it's really doing is it's reflecting within you an aspect of yourself that you haven't learned to love because you don't know. And so what happens is through that constriction of energy, existence will show you how that's inappropriate or out of harmony with existence. In examples that are personal but out here, and then as you ignore them they get closer and then eventually lodge in your body as disease from the Chinese idea of non-movement or constriction of energy. So he showed me that the simple idea of beauty, or what we perceive as good or beautiful, be it through the ears or the eyes, is actually this energy flowing through our body. And as soon as we perceive something that's non-beautiful, then what's happening is we just restricting the flow. And there's a saying from the Talmud which says, we don't see the world the way it is, we see it the way we are. And that mirror-like quality of reality or existence is what all the sages and mystics have spoken about through time, that this is actually just an elaborate mirror.
Let's slow down a bit, because you said so many fascinating things, I don't know where to go, you know, but I think I'm going to just go back to the beginning when you said Joseph Campbell, and you said you can go to these places, right?
Mm-hmm.
And wouldn't that be going to almost our origins? Because don't we kind of build our persona and our cultural selves out of our mythology? And until we get a new mythology, maybe we can't really, you know, somehow it has to be, something new has to get on the table as an option, right? And we don't even know it's an option because somehow we've never crossed its path. So then, because of the myths and the archetypes and all that stuff, and we think that they're limited, but I guess people say there's so many kinds, 12 kinds or whatever, you know. I mean, I haven't followed it because I really can't go for that, you know. I just say that's what's in the mythology. But Joseph Campbell studied what in so many cultures, and I guess there were similarities too, so that he figured, like, well, it must be universal, or there must be some greater truth there. It's not just cultural.
Mm.
And this is just my understanding of Joseph Campbell. And so you go to this place, right? And you see what's already pre-constructed for us,
yeah,
right? It's pre-constructed because, like,
possibly.
Somebody has given it to us as a mythology. It's part of our collective consciousness.
Possibly.
And we just go and see what see ourselves, you know. But I don't think that's really us, because it's horribly limiting if it's really us.
Mm.
I don't know.
Well, this is a perennial philosophical question. You know, what are we seeing? Is that us or is that other? And, you know, there's this idea that there are only these two things. There's self and other. And, of course, when you extend beyond that, you realize that the self and other, there's no differentiation even beyond that. So there could just be this thing which incorporates everything. So the philosophical arguments get bogged down simply because the cognitive mechanism that we're using to actually look at it is the mind. And the mind has a particular way in which it cognizes things. And it's much like our computers, which is no surprise because we've built computers in a type of reverse engineering fashion from the way in which we perceive that the mind and senses work.
Of course.
So its cognitive mode is through zeros and ones, right? It's a pathway. Is it this or that? Go that way. Is it this or that? So it's zeros and ones. And what happens is when we use the mind to look at living things, nature, existence, we can only ever see one thing at a time. one half of a coin.
Is our mind just zeros and ones also? Or is just, you know, because I can imagine we just made computers into zeros and ones because we had a little chip that had two states. It only has two states, you know, but if we had a chip that had five states, we'd have a five numeric system or something like that, or we could just as easily, right?
But, you know, the very idea of finding things in this perfection of timing, it's because there's actually a cognitive center, which we all know about, which is actually way more advanced in its cognitive function in terms of grokking nature, in terms of grokking living systems, and that's the heart. And the heart is 65% neural tissue. The heart is actually a much higher functioning cognitive center.
More neuron than muscle, you're saying,
yeah,
right?
I think,
because I never heard of that before.
Yeah. And, you know, encoded within language is a lot of what we're talking about. Specifically, imagine you're sitting at home with your personal computer. There's a certain amount of information that you can bounce backwards and forwards. But if one day someone comes along and hooks you up with a modem to go online, all of a sudden there's all these different websites. These are like different realities. And all of a sudden there's this vast thing to share that information with. And so what happens is some people perceive the pineal pituitary complex in harmony with the heart is a type of way in which we can actually start to access all these other types of realities, these other types of dimensions, which are essentially like websites. And so...
Well, let me ask you this. Are they all in imagination?
Again, this is a good question. What you're hitting on is a perennial philosophy.
Oh, yeah.
Where we
let me go back to the other one, too, because you can answer two in one, because you said the self and the other is a perennial philosophy. But I'm not really saying that, because I'm just wondering, is there anything there? Because all we're seeing is our mythology, you know?
Yeah, so
there's
mythology,
neither self or other there.
That's right, but mythology, it's very hard to tell, because if you're trying to analyze your computer from itself, you have this problem, because you need to be able to step outside and examine the self or the cognitive self from an external source. Otherwise, you're caught up in the witness are trying to witness the witness.
Yeah. And we're almost saying the witness is outside, you know, or are we, you know?
Yeah,
we're not really saying it. Or some people pretend like the witness is a higher state that doesn't have self or other in it. But I don't know what.
So again, this is like, I think Vedanta is a level of vibrational consciousness where you are going, I am this, I am that, this is this, that is that. Yeah. So the separation is just in the construct, which helps the mind navigate the idea that there is another, but it's conceptual. So imagine this is a mirror. Okay. When you wake up in the morning, and you look in the mirror and your hair's out of place, do you comb the reflection? Obviously not. Why? Because you know it would be fruitless, right? You know through you being taught that if you want to change that reflection, you change yourself. Presto, reflection changes. And yet we're engaging with the reflection on a day-to-day basis as if we can change it. And we're frustrated at our constant attempts to change the reflection, and it constantly keeps feeding back the same information. So we try harder. It's like trying to catch your shadow.
When does that become more than a metaphor? Because I think it can be experiential, but I think for a lot of people take that as a metaphor, you know, that something inside of me is like reflecting out here in my job, in my relationships, in my economic situation, in the city I live in. It really doesn't, the linkage doesn't really become that obvious.
Of course, if it was that obvious, everyone would be onto it straight away. And from my understanding of Buddha's teachings, the idea of judgment comes from the seed of need, you know, which I think was translated into desire. All desire leads to suffering. What does that mean? You know, so the desire is the desire to have the things we want more of, to have less of the things we don't like, less of. So that's the grasping and avarice. And so both of those lead to karma, because both of those develop habitual behavior, which becomes addictive and dependent, and drains the body of energy.
So karma is just that habitual behavior then,
yeah,
right?
Karma is just habitual patterning behavior and the reflection of existence showing that that's out of harmony with
So it comes
existence.
From a belief in the seed of need, which you said, right?
Yeah.
Something that, a neediness, in other words, neediness in certain areas, right?
Okay, so there's two. Imagine there is a self and other for this example.
Okay.
There's only two types of relationships that the self can have with the other. You can have relationships of need or relationships of not need. All relationships of need, which is what the Buddha was talking about with karma, are I need more or I need less. And all relationships of need lead to habitual behavior, dependence, addiction, and drain the body of energy.
Wow. You know, like we're also wrapped up in the relationships of need that we figure we don't have any time for relationships of no need.
Yeah, well, so relationships of not need are really interesting, because relationships of not need, which is exactly what existence is constantly nudging us towards, are what we call love. In other words, the two beings, self and other, are relating in a way where they are tapping into their own pool of infinite energy and giving and receiving at the same time. So both beings are rising in energy and vibration without any loss of signal coherence, without any loss of quality or quantity.
There's a synergy, actually. They're getting a gain that's more than the sum of the parts, right?
Exactly. So nature is of this ilk. And like a basic example of us trying to cognize nature through the mind, for example, is with mathematics.
Wait a minute. Mathematics is not nature.
No, I agree. But I was going to give you an example. In mathematics, you know, 1 + 1 = 2. It always 1 + 1 = 2. But if you take a seed, let's say a seed of a lotus, within that seed is a whole lotus plant with many flowers and many seeds, each one potentially another plant with more seeds. So 1 = infinity. This is a portal. But we don't have any mathematical understanding of how 1 can = infinity. Now, if you take a turtle, 1 turtle, you cut that in half, you've got 2 halves of a turtle. You put them back together, do you have a turtle? No. So half plus half
is 0.
Doesn't necessarily
just means
equal 1.
It's turtle soup, right?
Right. So what I'm illustrating here is that often we're using the mind to look at something which is beyond the mind. And the living systems that we're looking at using the mind, or scientific Cartesian type of analogy to try and work out through our zeros and ones what it is, we can have very close approximations. But when it comes to living stuff, there's no language to describe it. It's beyond the zeros and ones and beyond the mathematics.
Let's talk about Cartesian. That's it. I love that. You know, I love to talk about that.
Sure.
The Cartesian perception is just, well, there's space and time, and
it's measurable stuff. Again, it's this digital understanding. And again, one of the most remarkable things for me is the reverse engineering of the body and the mind to build what we call technology, which is extrusion from the causal plane, and we're building this technology to try and understand what it is that this bio-wetware is, because this bio-wetware, this body, has the most incredible possibilities, which most of us kind of know about. For example, bilocation or telepathy. Everyone has had some form of contact with a type of telepathy, whether it's you look at your phone, you know it's going to ring, it rings, you know who it is, and you're like, wow, how did I know that, right? But of course, taken to the nth degree, telecommunication systems like phones, if you draw where they will lead to, as Buckminster Fuller realized, they become smaller and smaller and smaller, more powerful, and eventually disappear. And where they disappear is, too, is we realize that we have a technology within our body which way surpasses this external technology. And so that external technology in itself becomes a training wheel. It helps us remember what the possibility and capability of the body is. And so when people read, you know, Autobiography of a Yogi, and he starts to go through these people in India and saints and some of their magical powers, you know, we kind of go, is that real? But part of us is excited about the idea that we know somewhere that that is real. The possibility is that you could dissolve your body over here and make it reappear over here. Why not? It's all just energy and matter. You just have to first have the belief that it's possible and be a technique. And within the body is already hardwired all of this information, but we don't have the instruction manual. So part of healing or art or shamanism is slowly trying to elucidate the instruction manual. And it just so happens that through nature we have the perfect tools, because it's all fractal, the microcosm mirrors the macrocosm. And so we only need to learn about one part, and then we can extrapolate the whole from that. And so there's work like Pratima was talking about with Nassim Harman, where he's showing the linkages between all the different levels of micro to macro. And as you start to learn one, they start to have, you could call them universal laws. And through the extrapolation of that, which is essentially the understanding of consciousness. So, you know, the Tibetan Buddhists are going here and learning about mind, which incorporates the heart and the mind. And scientists are going here and learning about atoms. But if you look a bit further in space-time, you'll see they all converge into the flowering of human consciousness, which is very interesting for now, because this is what seems to be occurring.
Now, what do you mean when
Earth?
You look further into space-time?
Well, space-time...
Further, does that mean future or what? When you mean
yes.
Further? By further into time or
yes
what?
Yes or no, because the mind can only perceive things like space and time or space-time as on a linear fashion, where we're moving from the past, we're always in the present, and we're always moving towards the future. And it's linear. In other words, the further into the future we're going, the further away from the past we're moving as a point.
Yeah. And but I mean,
and that's a linear
perspective.
I think
a lot of us know that that's just kind of
like, but I think space-time's actually spheroid.
Yeah. I don't know. I think a lot of us know that that's just a perception. You know, we're always here, right?
Yes.
And then, I don't know what. What's the past is a memory, and the future is a projection. So then, doesn't have a lot of dimension to it, does it?
Yes or no?
It's a memory. Where are memories, you know? How does memory work? I mean, why do we have memories? Where are these images, anyhow? Mm. I mean, are we going to just say they're in these kind of synapses, or what are we going to say?
Well, I doubt it. It's like that analogy is like saying that all the TV shows are in the box. No, they're not. The box is like a transducer or receiver.
Right.
And it's receiving from the field a stream of information. And so the characters and all those shows are not in the box.
Yeah, well, I mean, even that's another thing, because we say, we almost talk like energy is primary, you know, but really... Okay, the box has energy, like this body-mind mechanism needs energy.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, who knows what these thoughts are? And they're not really transmitted. We can't find them as waves or anything, or can we? They're not like radio waves.
Yeah.
So then maybe they're not even energy. I don't know.
Well, I think there's energy and there's energy and there's energy. There's a huge... electromagnetic spectrum, the five senses that we're familiar with are tuning into a very narrow band.
Right, I get that.
And so when we say energy, it's hard to talk about it without first
Yeah.
understanding whether we're talking about the same thing in terms of energy. But
Well, I never heard you say that, so I don't even know if you say energy. I just kind of brought that up. But I mean, like, okay, I mean, how about stillness? Is stillness energy? I would say it's not.
I'd say it's a form
It's a
of energy in terms of energy, in terms of consciousness, is all pervasive. It covers everything from the nothing to the everything and everything in between. And
energy
so
does.
consciousness.
Oh,
And
consciousness.
consciousness is like a, you see, again, energy, there's a scientific definition of energy. But when we start to talk about these concepts that have, start to spread into the realms of, the etheric realms, it's hard because we need to go, well, hold on, are we talking scientific energy here? Or are we talking like prana, chi? These are energies that aren't necessarily measurable by scientific instrumentation,
But the
but
reflection is. The
the
reflection of
reflection
Kri
is
is definitely
sure.
measurable.
So like there's the whole Chinese medicinal system, for example, is based on moving qi around the body with acupuncture and foods and tai chi and qigong and ideas and belief systems. And your health is dependent upon the way in which this energy moves through your body. And science still hasn't found the nadis and the meridians and the chakras. It has to some degree, but most Cartesian science would say no, we
They can't
haven't.
find them. They can't find them because I mean, you can hold your hand over a chakra and feel it, and then now they're saying they put electrodes on leaves and stuff, and they can see when you say you're a bad leaf, and it goes.
Yeah,
But I
but
mean,
still, if you go into the halls of traditional science, they'll laugh at you and go, "What are you talking about? That's not proven. That could be this or that or that." If it
some
was,
stray noises, in other words, because it's
yeah.
so subtle, right? So then,
And not only that,
but they're saying
if
it's
there was a
repeatable.
belief in that,
Yeah.
science would already have shifted to start taking that on board. And because commerce is so fast off the mark, there would be the commercial expansion of those ideas, and we would have
Nah.
things like
Well, no,
free
there wouldn't,
energy
you know,
and
because when you
energy
said that,
healing.
when you said that what is the direction of the cell phone like? It's getting smaller and smaller, and finally it'll disappear, right? So then the disappearance is not going to get commercialized, right? Because that's where the commercial drops off, right? And so then there's going to be a great resistance to the disappearance of anything, even health. You know, there's going to be a
And
great
that's what we have
resistance to
today,
health.
the
Yeah.
pharmaceutical industries. And you could call it the wellness industry, but it's the opposite. It's the
It's the
non-wellness, the
sickness
sickness
industry.
industry. That's right. The reason those are coming to fore is simply because within the idea of the way in which we're talking right now is that they have vested interests in people not being well, because otherwise their businesses will start to fail. And so the point at which we are in time on this planet is such that all of these things are rising to the surface for us to look at.
Well, I've looked at it a lot, and I really, for a couple of years, I've really thought about it. I've not necessarily had a solution, especially a couple of years ago. But what I've thought about is like the profit motive can't deliver. You know, basically, I've looked at our money system and economics as a distribution system. How do we trade stuff, and how do we relate? Because the world is a relationship, right? And
Absolutely.
so money is like is the distribution system of that relationship. And the profit motive can't distribute a hell of a lot of stuff, you know, because whatever the profit motive depends totally on scarcity. You know,
That's
without
right.
scarcity, it breaks down because the free market breaks down if there's too much supply. I mean, health is just abundant, you know, and then all of a sudden health isn't worth a plug nickel, right? And so then some other system, what other kind of a system could deliver health care? Could deliver, you know,
Good question.
education, could deliver, you know, information about about the world, you know.
I think it's a fundamental relationship issue. So, and it's born out of an original schism. A schism meaning a tear,
A
a
split, huh?
split. Racism, sexism, any ism is a rent in the idea of who we think we are in relation to who we truly are.
Okay. So that's the original schism? Like, you know, that we've, that, well, it's kind of like that we've wrenched ourselves out of something and said, here's this little mound of sand and that's me and I'm going to defend it.
Yeah, and in a sense, okay, so let me describe it this way. Our relationship to things like property is we feel we own things and therefore ownership gives us rights. Whereas if you look at a lot of the old world cultures, they are custodians and they have responsibilities.
Right on.
So viewing from the outside, you may not be able to see much of a difference. But there is a vast difference, and that difference is the very thing that's putting the world on the course of destruction. Because
I totally agree.
Let's say
we own.
We think we own a piece of land. We can't possibly own a piece of land. There's an idea that we can own the land, and we can get a piece of paper, a legal piece of paper that says we own the land, and we may have to have an army and police to defend
that piece of paper.
Piece of paper that's saying we own the land.
Right.
But of course, if we owned it, we could take it and move it somewhere else.
Yeah, yeah.
Or take it with us when we died.
Right.
So we don't own it. We have an idea that we own it. But let's pretend we thought we owned this land. And there's this giant tree in the middle. And if we think we're an owner, we have a right
we
to
own
cut
the tree
down
too.
That tree.
Yeah, we own the tree too. And everything
so we
on the
can
land.
Make the decision.
And then that's the question, do we own what's under the land or how about what's above the land?
Exactly.
The airspace and all
it
that stuff?
It starts to become amorphous.
Oh, yeah.
So
it's
as
not
a custodian,
amorphous, it's just all the things we're grasping for.
Mm.
We're trying to own all those other things.
Right.
You know?
And so in the mind, we can own these things. But the truth of it is we can't. And so what happens is we start to interact with the land and each other from this idea of ownership, which essentially is what modern psychology calls the ego or personas. This is a relationship or wrong relationship with ourselves, which is reflected into relationship with each other, which is reflected in relationship to the land. So in Buddhism, they say, you know, there's three precious jewels, Buddha, Dharma, Sangha. And to the Aboriginal people, who probably should be called the original people, like Aborigine, abnormal, they're the original people of this land. They have an equivalent three precious jewels, which would be law, L-O-R-E, kinship, and custodianship. And what these three precious jewels define is relationship to self, relationship to other people, like community, and relationship to land. And if we get the one right, the others automatically unfold. So the primary relationship is to self because everything reflects that primary relationship. So what is the right relationship to self? And in fact, from that stems one single practice that is could be argued is the only practice, which is cultivate self-love.
Wow, you are killing me. You know, you're so perfect. You are the things you say. I mean, okay, I was thinking before about the money and the distribution system and the profit motive can't deliver what we want to deliver, you know. And then I know ownership is like a main key, you know, like the somehow ownership has to be redefined, right? And especially on natural monopolies and stuff like that.
Sure, and people.
And
like we try to own our partners and our children.
Well, we used to own slaves and stuff like that too. Mm. But this is so perfect, like the three tenets are like, because like mostly spirituality seems to stop at the first tenet. Who am I? I'm nothing. Okay, it's vast here.
Mm.
And then there's no relationship to the land or to other people because they're not here now. And so then they must be a thought or an idea. Mm.
So for example, right relationship to land could be defined in physical, actual terms. So over time, right relationship to land means the land will become more fertile. It'll be able to support more life and more complex living systems, more biodiversity. These are the physical exudations of the land from right relationship.
Yeah, if right relationship then means like stewardship, right?
Exactly.
And sustainability, right?
That's right.
Where now we just owners just extract from the land, and then and then they just discard it and go some more, and then desertification and stuff like that happens.
And in fact, beyond sustainability, because if I said to you, "What's your relationship with your wife?" and you said sustainable,
she's not getting really that going, much older, but I want to make her like younger, that. Right?
Right. So nature. You know, a tree will not produce the right amount of blossoms for those five plums that it needs to propagate. It'll just produce an abundance. And so sustainability kind of, again, is one of those words that traps us because we are not sustainable. We way over
Unity. We're way out of it, you know. But sustainability is a new word that we're just discovering, you know, and it can take on a bit. It's still
and compared
got,
to what we've had, it's fantastic.
It can take
on
a lot bigger baggage, yeah. No, it can grow, you know.
Yeah. So all I'm saying is sustainable compared to what we've had, which is this total resource
extraction. Extraction
is great.
We had. Yeah.
But what we're really aiming for is biomimicry. What we're really aiming for is like looking at nature, which already is the example of how living systems have this perpetual renewal. How that one cycle actually leads to more. And more and more, because everything's growing and everything's moving. And as science will soon determine, the planet is expanding. The very idea that the planet is a static size is connected to our conservative idea of what it is we
are. Well, we don't even have to go there. I mean, this fertility could be expanding, you know? Mm. And something about unpolluted resources could be expanding, you know, like the field that we can actually survive in and thrive in can be expanding. And we don't even need to go there and say, well, we've got, now we weigh, the Earth weighs a couple kilograms more. I don't know if we need that, you know.
Well, you know, you were talking about economy.
Right.
Right. The idea of scarcity comes from this initial idea of limitation. And that initial idea of limitation in relation to resource of the earth. There's a limited amount of water on earth. There's a limited amount of earth on earth. There's a limited amount of fresh air and blah, 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 blah. What happens if there wasn't?
No, but all that recycles. All the water recycles. All the air recycles.
What happens
I don't know
if
about
there's
the land
more
recycles
water,
too.
What happens if there was more water on earth every single day? What happens if there was more earth on earth?
Well, there's
every
not more
day?
Water because it's either in the sea, in the air, or in the ground, or in the rivers, right?
Maybe.
Okay.
I disagree.
Yeah. But I mean, why do you don't even have to. I mean, you don't really have to disagree because, like, the
I think
the,
there's more...
the systems we have are so perfect and work so good.
Mm.
And if we and I think scarcity comes from what I said, the distribution system only market only works on scarcity. And so that's been impressed on everything.
Yes,
you know?
Yeah.
Because the moment something's not scarce, we turn our back on it and deny it and say that's why old wives' tales or something.
Yeah, yeah. I'm going back to the original idea of where competitiveness and scarcity comes from. And
paradigm.
It's from the mind, the limitation of the mind, the limitation of the idea of who we think we are being limited. Because when we view ourselves as the body having a spiritualized projection, then there's limitation.
Right.
Whereas if we realize we are spirit having a physical experience,
right? Well, you said it all right there. Because if we realize, see, and that's why I kind of hate to go there in the first place. And then because then you'll say if we verify, if we verify that all is one,
yes,
okay. But in the meantime, we're all we're all a bunch of parrots. So how can we verify anything? Because parrots just parrot.
Mm. And the verification is a mental process. The mind needs verification. The heart doesn't. The heart is a cognitive
organ. I'm saying
organ.
If you start with a blank slate, you don't have to verify anything. You could just discover it.
True.
So
and that's why
not say
that's
too
why
much
people
spiritual
are looking
truths, you know.
Yeah, that's why people look at children and that level of innocence and they're going, well, in a sense, children have a kind of really amazing grasp on what's going on because they are living in a type of limitless world. And then slowly but surely, these filters of limitation start to
well,
impede.
They're living in presence, you know.
In presence.
So, but they're not really limited. I mean, at least we can't see that and limit, you know, unlimited because we're the one that gives them a bottle of milk.
Mm-hmm.
right? So then I don't know what. Maybe that's a good metaphor, maybe not. But I mean, as far as their mentality goes, they have a presence that can be appropriate.
And so then the trick is, how do we go through life and rediscover that original innocence with the wizened cognitive function? In fact, the mind, as in terms of the brain, maybe the process is to develop the logic to a certain point and then reconnect. In other words, realize the superseding or the superiority of the logic is a fallacy, and then reconnect back to that original innocence. And so a lot of the spiritual practice is around this. The development of wisdom is taking the knowledge, realizing the knowledge isn't it. The knowledge is just like a tool. We have to actually then reconnect with, let's say, the cognitive organ of the heart being the center of human cognitive function, so that we
let's
then
run that whole thing again, you know, because I mean, that's too important just to whiz by. You know, I mean, you're saying that the knowledge is a tool, right? Or is it just a confusion?
Well, look, let's go back to our analogy of computers, right? Let's say you want to know something. Everyone is already coming to the understanding, if you have a Google, right, it's the question you ask, the quality of the questioning will get you to, through that search term, will get you to information. But it's still just information. It's what you do with it. How valuable is that information in enriching your life? And enriching your life in a way that's in harmony with your community and the earth is really what's valuable, because ultimately, if it's enriching one part without the other, you start to create these polarities. And this, in its final stage,
you mean one part without the other, the self instead of the community, or?
Yeah, in other words, what you're talking about, the greed-profit dynamic, is not understanding that we're connected to everything else. And so we pool higher levels of, let's call it money, wealth, in this spot. And because relative to it, you have a low level, you ultimately creating
a divide.
You're creating that polarity, and the energy wants to rebalance. Nature's constantly moving towards balance. And so over time, the more and more you separate, you get...
So there's going to be a stress there, right? Because that's how nature does it, how they rebalance it. It rebalances through stress.
Yeah, look at bees, right? Bees, or what I would call honeypot economics, okay? They will go along to flowers. And these flowers could be far away, like 6 kilometers away. And they're collecting little bits of nectar and pollen from each flower, which is fairly evenly distributed in the landscape. And they bring it all back to one central place. And that's a sweet spot where that honey is. And of course, all of a sudden, there's a whole lot of other things, bears, birds, humans. They want that sweetness because it's concentrated sweetness. So the bees have to develop stings to defend their honey. So you see that the level of abundance isn't the only factor in economics. So during the Middle Ages, or the Dark Ages, so in Europe, you had little pools of wealth defended by fortresses and castles and armies, and everyone was fighting over this small amount of resource, when at the same time in Mesoamerica, you had the temple, you know, the pyramid building cultures, the Mesoamericans of the Maya and the Olmecs. They had these vast gardens, and there's no fortification. There's just these incredible roadways through the jungle connecting all these pyramid complexes, and people are living in relative harmony. That's because through the jungle cultures, there's a distribution of energetic wealth through their relationships to plants. And so there's enough abundance that everyone can experience this abundance on this level. It's only when you start to concentrate it that you start to have this economic pressure that creates violence and war, because the moment there's a stress on the system and the have-nots all of a sudden have not, and they see a vast resource of the haves, what stops them saying, well, you know, my family's dying here, I'm going to get some of that, and will develop their tools into weapons to go and get it. And this is where war comes from.
So then we reflect pretty much our location, because like those societies developed in the tropical paradises and jungles where there's so much lush plant life, picking fruit and catching fish. I mean, who would even hoard fish? Because what would you do with them? Anyone can have as much as they want, right? And so then there's no value in these things, and the value has to be in family or in some kind of tradition or in some kind of ritual many things, right?
You can look at the history of people on the earth is related to their relationship to the country, to, let's say, food and plants. And the more connected they are, they realize you cut down the forest, we're actually shooting ourselves in the foot. And where humans start to live in more marginal areas, they have incredible strategies. So if you look at the Native Americans of the Northwest, the Haida and Kwatkul, and you'll see that they develop systems, I think it's called potlatch, or what's now become potluck, okay, where you'll have a number of communities, and they realize that they're living in a relatively resource poor in comparative to a jungle system. And so what they develop a strategy where all the excesses of each of these communities will all be donated to one community on 1 year, and then to the next in a cycle. So that every 5 years or so, one community gets to have this boom. And from that excess, they can relax a bit and develop their culture, their singing, their dancing, their art, because they know that on that year, they're going to have a bumper year no matter what. And because that's rotating, it means the idea of scarcity, that kind of stress of we don't know what's around the corner, we don't know how nature is going to treat us, we don't know how bad this winter is, starts to dissipate. And so the idea of living in communities is you start to get these economies of scale and scope, which enable vast amounts of energy to be liberated and enables culture to be spawned. Does that make sense?
That's very intriguing. You know, I just like the Aboriginal ideas, and I want to go a little more back to that, you know, because the relationship to self, the relationship to the land or the environment, and the relationship to community or other people. And somehow spirituality has kind of always been the relationship to self.
Yep.
And then people do relationship work and stuff like that, you know, about other people, but nobody ever talks about the land or about possessions or ownership. And then these three things, now let's just look at them. Could they be part of the law of the land? You know, certainly ownership can be part of the law of the land. Already we've got, yeah, those are contract law, and then there's relationship laws is kind of laws about how we should relate to each other. And there's not too many laws on yourself. You have to know yourself or something like that. But, I mean, we're always in an old context trying to modify it, right? And because it hasn't broken yet, we're trying to just kind of tweak it. And spirituality. And so then we're always working from within the context and try to, and so the limitations of that context are going to be in what the outpouring of what we create. And spirituality, in a way, is kind of like context breaker, because we're trying to go to the root, say, well, what's within me that reflects out here that keeps popping up in my life? And, you know, even without knowing where that is, where are my memories, where are my images, where are my feelings, all that stuff, we could just notice that they're patterned. And so then what could spirituality could also be something that would break the context of our ownership of land, stewardship of land. What we said was sustainability, or a new word for sustainability, you know, a new meaning for sustainability that could mean some kind of stewardship and actually enrichment instead of impoverishment.
Mm.
And then somehow a new inclusiveness about how our fellow man is really, you know, even if we don't see that we're all one, we can just see that we are codependent and, you know, and that we can reflect each other in love as long as we don't make up some kind of excuses that he deserves it. You know, because with interpretation, we cut all energies, right? Concepts cut energies and make us separate, and then the absence of concepts seems to just let us be together. What's the future of this spirituality that's going to be more
inclusive, integrated?
Well, not only inclusive, but let's just say relevant. What the hell? Just say relevant, you know? Because I mean, I'm willing to say spirituality is kind of out of it, you know?
Well, you know, like, know thyself. If you start from the self as in the primary relationship, who am I? With investigation, we realize that the boundary of self starts to expand and include our community and the earth and, in fact, the whole universe. The self has no edge. It's at that point we realize the self is the other. So that the spiritual path, although it's only looking at the self as the little self first, if you take it to its end, it will be all-inclusive. Now, the Native Americans from the Southwest have a saying, does it grow corn? Which basically means, like, what's its practical value here on Earth to me now? Because everything else is basically entertainment. So there's a number of ways in which we can ask ourselves questions that will constantly bring us back to this idea. So Bill McDonough, who is a designer.
Yeah, I've heard of him.
He had this.
Is that Cradle to Cradle?
Yes. And he asked this question. How do we love all of the children of all species for all time? So what you're doing is you are taking a set of words which will constantly bring you back to anything you're doing in your life and go, well, is this loving all of the children of all species for all time? And what that will do is it'll constantly recalibrate your life into what's really important and relevant, which is often what happens with a near-death experience. You know, you're running along, you're doing this, you have your life and your business and all the things that you're doing that you think are important. And you'll maybe be in a car accident and you'll come out thinking, wow, that was close. I nearly lost my life. Maybe even spend some time in hospital. And you reevaluate, you recalibrate and you go, wow, this thing I'm working on, this business of mine, wow, if I would have died, that's not such a big deal. What about my family I'm neglecting?
Incompletion, you know, we're all living in such incompletion, right? And we're just saying like...
So this recalibration.
Recalibration. Huh?
Which in the traditional cultures was called initiation, is this constant reminder of the value of what we really have. And so anything that we can find within our modern cultural context that can reorient us back to ourselves, which ultimately will lead back to right relationship with each other and the land, is valuable. So asking the question, does it grow corn, is simple and yet really deep. Just like Mayor Baba, who as an avatar, you know, may have had a meter and a half of text of right relationship to each other, self and the world, condensed all of that down into four words, you know, don't worry, be happy. And you may think, well, hold on a minute, that's oversimplifying it. But is it really? You know, personally, I have six words. So, you know, I've yet to kind of get to a single word, maybe, like love. But resistance is persistence, and acceptance initiates change. And for me, those six words have been an incredible catalyst in trying to define and constantly bring me back to this idea of easiness, the idea of going with the flow. Because if we are feeling resistance, we are propagating the very system that we're trying to resist.
Well, we have choice, right? So there's some choice in that, in that field that you've just laid out, right?
Yeah.
And sometimes we don't want change, right? So then resistance is persistence. That's our choice. And then acceptance promotes change or like initiates change.
Yeah, so think of it like when we're growing up in school, there's this basic concept that if we don't like it, change it. You know, like how many people have had this scenario where maybe when they were younger and they met a lover, you know, their first love, and they were like, oh my God, he or she is amazing, you know, and they're like this and they're this and they're this. They smoke cigarettes or thing, but that's okay. That'll soon change. Do you know what I mean? And over time you go, wow, you just can't change, because the very things that we're trying to change, the very energy
persist,
has to come from a judgment of this is wrong. And from that judgment comes that habitual patterning, that dependence, that vested emotional energy in a change. That very energy supplies existence. Its mode is to, in the most benign way possible, show us how that is out of harmony with the way things are. And so it will start to create hurdles to push us back onto this path, this graceful path. And of course, the more we ignore them, the more intense those hurdles become, and then we call them accidents or disease. Because what essentially is happening is existence is so benign that it is offering us whatever in its array of tools it can to show us the way. And of course, the most guiding energetic that we've come to understand from a human perspective is love. Love is this energetic guidepost which will constantly move us onto this graceful path, this path of easiness, of least resistance. And anything other than that will lead to what Buddha calls the world of karma or suffering. But know this, there's no path that does not lead to the divine. It doesn't matter what you do. Some may be more suffering, may seem to take a longer time. But on a spheroid ball of consciousness, every point is closest to the center. So right now, the couch we're sitting on is directly over the center of the earth. In fact, there's no place on the surface of the earth that is not directly over the center of the earth. So imagine in the center of earth was God, and the earth was transparent. And one day you looked down and you went, oh my God, I've found the divine. And you called over to your Jewish brother, come here, I've found God. And of course he's going, no, you can't have found the closest path to the divine. I have it. It's right here below me. And of course your Muslim brother's going, no, sorry,
it's over here.
I have it. Muhammad showed me it's here. How could you have the shortest path? I've obviously, there's nothing between me and the divine here. And so in spheroid consciousness, everything has the shortest path to the divine. That's just the way it's set up. But because the mind works on a linear plane, only one of us can have it. And we're all fighting over who's right.
All these planes, huh? I ask you that my original question is, what is healing? You gave me such a full answer. I tell you, healing the answer, you know?
So the answer to healing is, for me, a really interesting perspective. Imagine you are a spiritualized being. Let's call it a soul for a linguistic sake.
What the heck? Yeah.
You're a spiritual being having a physical experience, let's say. The spiritual being is already immortal and in a sense perfected. And the physical being, your physical being, has arrived by a very long lineage. Millions, perhaps billions of years, possibly from single cell organisms, your mother's lineage. Not once did one of your ancestors die before procreating in your mother's lineage, billions of years, and in your father's lineage, the same. So you've got these two multi-million or billion year lineages joining. And so your body is already a super intelligent being. Right now, you sitting here, it's going, the trillion cells that make up your body are living in relative harmony, and they're doing all sorts of things. They're digesting, they're getting rid of toxic waste, they're taking up oxygen, they're healing, they're doing incredible functions that you as a person may not be aware of, right? So you've got this body, which is a super intelligent, almost perfected being to cope in nature, joining up with this immortal avatar to form a human body on Earth. And the only thing between these two perfected poles that can be out of harmony or out of dissonance is the idea of who we think we are. Or you could say the egoic person. And when that's in harmony with these two poles, we experience wellness. And when it's out of harmony, the way existence shows us that we're out of harmony with these two perfected poles is what we call disease. Now, in the Vedas...
So somehow between those two places is this egoic?
Well,
so this egoic thing is in here.
That's right,
jumping
and it can
around.
Swing backwards and forwards. Yeah. And when it comes into alignment, we experience not only health and wellness, we experience orgasm, we experience beauty, we experience higher states of consciousness, we experience what it is to be alive. When we out of harmony with those two poles, then we experience what we call sickness or disease.
Or ugliness.
And all that is trying to be that flow stops. Those rails along the road trying to bounce you back into the road, saying, whoa, you go out there, there's no road that way. You can go off-road, but your vehicle can pack up. You know, there may not be petrol for the next 5,000 miles, whatever it is. So disease is a way of telling us where we're out of harmony.
To recenter us,
to bring us back to balance. Mm-hmm. And so balance...
And it has to be with stress, because we were saying nature rebalances with stress, right?
The stress is the idea of who we think we are. The further out of alignment, the more stress, because we're trying to get to this other place. Whereas essentially sitting back within who we are and imagining that everything is perfected is the least stressful position, which is why this is where meditation goes. In other words, to meditate is not a doing, it's a not doing. It's a stillness. If you stop trying, this meditation naturally arises. It's always there. But to try and meditate, you can never get there, because it's like trying to catch your shadow. The faster you go, it'll always keep pace. The trick is you stop, shift your orientation, and your shadow will come and sit in your lap. So to chase your shadow or any addictive neediness, because of course we're all seeking the same thing, to give and receive love and appreciation. But if we were never taught that the source or the font of all love is inside us, we're always seeking it out there in the mirror. And then we're thinking, well, if I'm a little bit more beautiful, maybe if I'm a little bit more wealthy, then maybe I'll get the love.
The seed of need.
And this leads to the whole world of glamour. Glamour is looking at ourselves through the eyes of other people, going, what is it that I need to be loved? And shaping our whole life around that. Whereas if at a young age we were taught, well, no, the source of love is inside of you, then it would be different, because you would go, huh, I already have this thing. Now I can interact with people out of non-need, which is love. And this is the birth of the true gifted economy. When a mother's breastfeeding a child, she's not going, all right, that's 5 minutes, I'll write that down in my book, because when you're older, you're going to owe me washing up or whatever. At that moment, she's giving without any expectation of return. And that's what nature does. That's the true gifted economy. That's what we're all seeking, really, internally, and looking for it externally, is this idea of love. Love made manifest, which we call nature. And it's beautiful.
It's very, very rich speaking with you.
Oh, thank
it's
you.
It's just really terrific. You know, I don't know. I'm almost afraid to go on because I think it could last all night, you know, as long as these questions pop out and these amazing responses come.
And, well, you know, talking is a relationship. The energy of that supports the vocal cords to speak comes from the ears of the listener. So if you don't have the ability to hear, then that energy is not supporting for the voice to speak. And so it's a collaborative effort. It's not me using all my energy to tell you stuff. Yeah. It's you using your energy to support this energy flowing through me, and then it switches around. And then, because there can never be an unequal exchange.
Wow. That's so beautiful. So all you guys are just what keeps me talking. See, you thought I was putting this a number on you, right? But really, it's your intention to listen, that really. And I appreciate it. I totally appreciate it.
And now we're coming into what's called the sixth sun, a new sun. And what it is the flowering of human consciousness, because it's going in these bubbles. Like you say, it seems to go retrograde. But we're now coming to a point in time which some people call the sixth sun, which will be a rediscovery of what the sun is. Because essentially, if like from the Upanishads, the ocean and the mountains and the earth and the stars all exist in a lotus-shaped temple in your heart. I'm paraphrasing, of course. And everything out there is actually just in here. And the heart is the sun. Our relationship, our new understanding of what the heart is, our new relationship with the sun, for example, in relationship to the earth, will start to give us a different understanding of the relationship of the earth to the sun. And we will then be able to radiate back that love instead of just bathing in the light. And it's this relationship that I was talking about of the ear listening is as important as the voice speaking. The earth and the love that is shared between the beings on earth is as important to the quality of the sunlight coming from the sun.
Wow. That's so useful, you know, that because storying changes how we look at things.
Sure.
And then this is a story, sure, but I mean, it just means that we're all responsible, but we're all actually... we're all co-authors. We are the world, in a way.
That's right. And so, in a sense, the whole of existence could be nurturing self-responsibility, because ultimately, it's realizing who we are and stepping up to that idea of this largeness of who we are, which takes the most courage, because ultimately, when we realize that it starts and ends with ourselves as individuals, then we start to really make things work. That's when we start to see the celestial music. That's when we start to relate to each other out of love, because we realize that we are responsible. We're responsible for everything.
Really? It's not so hard. It's not really hocus pocus. I mean, it's just... It even makes sense. I mean, I don't think we have to wait for any kind of awakening or enlightenment or sureness experience. I think we can just act
start
on that
right
and
now.
Know on it. And just like you said, McDonald, William McDonald,
yeah.
That I want to take all the babies of every species for all time.
Yeah.
And somehow cherish
so,
them.
So how do we love all the children of all species for all time? You know, is like, well, you've got to be thinking about what you're doing now, how that's going to affect, you know, the future, hence the babies, but not just humans, of all species,
right?
And for all time. So it's the context is focused down to like, all right, so everything we do
right.
is the ultimate custodian. And that's the role of being human on Earth.
Yeah, well, for all time, it's like there's no degradation.
That's right.
There has to be kind of like natural improvement, system, you know?
It can endlessly
And you're
recreate
just speaking
itself.
Of the recreation of the seed into the many, into the, where one equals infinity. And yep. you're saying, and we can know that a half plus a half doesn't equal one. You know, yep. some of the old mathematics is not... It's
well,
that's true.
It's very useful. It just doesn't necessarily relate to living systems in the way in which, you know, we need it to. Because we need it to, if we're doing commerce, if it's all about commerce, then we need to know how many you can grow from that one and how fast
right.
and what you can get for it. And so the English language tends to be very good at all these describing of things because essentially it may have evolved a lot out of this commercial need, and so it's very descriptive in size and color and shape. May not be that descriptive in love. How many words are there to describe?
Yeah, you can't sell that stuff. What you can't sell is not very
Well, some people may argue with
yeah,
you, but
well,
I agree.
They sell something. They sell AirSats, right? And anyhow, Daniel, I totally thank you.
Thank
Fantastic.
You so much.
Fantastic.
I appreciate
for you to visit us.
Hanging out and talking. Yeah. It's great.
Daniel Schreiber.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks everyone for coming to check us out. This is Australia. You're going to really get a dose of it and you're going to really love it. And so come again, come often. Thank you, yeah. Daniel.
Thank you, Richard.